Welcome. The Smithsonian National Museum of African Art would like to thank you for joining us today as we welcome the Nigerian artist, TAYO Fatunla. Our program today is entitled, Our Roots. Discover the wonderful world of cartooning and animation as we celebrate October and Black History Month in the UK. My name is Pierre Pennick, Education Specialist for K-12 programming, and I will be your host. October marks Black History Month in the UK. Today's program was inspired by Carter G. Woodson, known as the father of Black History Month. Carter G. Woodson was a scholar and educator dedicated to celebrating the historic contributions of people of African descent. Black History Month has been documented every February since 1976. Woodson believed that everyone should understand the largely overlooked achievements of African Americans. As we celebrate Black History Month in the UK today, let us remember that our people from African and Caribbean backgrounds have been a fundamental part of British history for centuries. As we celebrate Black History Month in the UK, let us document that it was first celebrated in the UK in 1987. Our featured artist today is TAYO Fatunla, cartoonist, designer, illustrator, caricaturist, storyteller, cartoon tutor, visual communicator, and motivational speaker. He is a member of Cartoon Arts International. He's also a member of Cartoon Movement and Cartooning for Peace. TAYO Fatunla is an artist of the African diaspora, a comic artist, a writer, and an author committed to documenting Black history through his award-winning illustrated educational drawings. Our Roots was first syndicated in the U.S. by Cartoonist and Writer Syndicate. He has held Our Roots exhibitions at various venues, including the Studio Harlem Museum in New York, and has lectured on Our Roots at universities in the U.S., France, Italy, Ireland, Ethiopia, and the UK, and at workshop sessions and events. TAYO is a graduate of the prestigious Kubert School in New Jersey, in the US, where our man, and he is a recipient of the 2018 ECBACC Pioneer Lifetime Achievement Award for his illustrated Our Roots creation and series, Famous Black People. Works he has done in the BBC, the British Museum, and the Guardian UK stems out of the popularity and format of Our Roots. He is a graduate of the prestigious art school in New Jersey, as well as doing workshops, cartoon workshops, art workshops in Nigeria, Cameroon, Finland, France, Egypt, Belgium, Italy, and Ireland. He has also presented works at the Royal Shakespeare Company, Stratford-upon-Avon, England. Please, let us welcome TAYO Fatunla. Thank you.
Don't worry about a thing. Every little thing's gonna be all right. Oh, hello. How are you? My name is TAYO from the United Kingdom, and in the United Kingdom, we're celebrating the Black History Month, being proud of who you are. Black History Month in the United Kingdom is celebrated every year in October, and I always say it's being proud of who you are. So I want to thank the Smithsonian Natural Museum of African Art, giving me the opportunity to share my drawings, my art, my journey in the area of drawing on Black history with you. So I hope you have a good time with this session. And I know that by the end of the session, you all would have learned a lot about drawing cartoons and also drawing educational materials as well, just like Our Roots, and learning from me as well. So what I wanted to know is that it's good to have plan B, and plan B is to have a good education, because Nelson Mandela said, education is the most powerful weapon in which you can use to change the world. Education is the most powerful weapon in which you can use to change the world. And that's not just in the United Kingdom, not just in America, but all around the world. And my drawings on Black history, which started from my school in New Jersey, the Kibbutz School of Cartoon and Graphic Art in New Jersey, is now an award-winning feature all around the world. So I'm going to share with you a PowerPoint presentation based on cartoons and my work as well, and also a bit of animation, which was a product of the lockdown. I had to be very creative during lockdown, so I came up with a new book, and I also came up with a mini animation on Black history. So I'm going to share all these with you, okay? So I'm going to go to the PowerPoint and do a PowerPoint presentation for you. So we're going to start. I'm going to share the screen with you. Just bear with me. Here we are. I'm going to share the screen with you. All right. And what I'm going to do is get you to see, make it bigger so you can see what's on the screen, okay? Now, Black history is being proud of who you are. Like I said, education is the most powerful weapon in which you can use to change the world. And we're going to learn a lot from our roots and just enjoy the ride. It's going to be a roller coaster fun of learning how to draw cartoons all the way from the United Kingdom. Ain't you lucky? We're going to have fun now. Here we go. Now, I'm going to show you a few things about drawing cartoons. So I'm going to go to the next page, which is this one here. During the lockdown, I was able to do a little bit of animation, and you will see what happens to these. This is me, actually. Yeah, watch out, doc. Look at my buck teeth there. Similar to what you see on the screen. Yeah, that's it. Well, I'm going to play this little bit of animation and see what happens. You need to be very creative as time goes on, because if you don't move with times, times will leave you behind. So I'm sharing this with you for you to enjoy what I did during lockdown. I also did my book on Black history, my second volume on Black history called Our Roots. Now, look at this one and see what happens. What do you see there? Hey, look at my head bump. Look at my head moving there. It's what I experimented with during my during the lockdown. This is fun. I always enjoy doing experimenting with new ideas. I had actually a year's animation education at the Kibbutz School in Dover, New Jersey. And through the years, I've been able to appreciate animation much more than ever before. And that's my drawing there on me. I'm bucking my head there, and I hope you enjoyed that little bit of creative work I did there with my drawing. That's introducing myself to you. Now, when it comes to drawing cartoons, cartoons can be fun. And I want you to understand that images attract a lot. Images speak more volumes than just words. Images can speak thousands and thousands of volumes. And that's what we're going to learn today. So I'm going to go to the next one. See the head bumping? I just love that. I always enjoy doing that. I'm going to move to the next one now, which is that one. Okay, so here we are. What does it take to be a cartoonist? You need materials. All the information here are very important to drawing cartoons. You need to do comic panels. You want to do comic books. You need a table and a good chair to sit on, so that when you sit on your chair, you don't hurt your back. You need a scanner, which I do. You need a rubber, and you need a pencil. You need to be very creative. You need new ideas as well. And I do that. You need caricatures, computers. You need to sketch as well. And you need to color your work as well. Because I started my work in black and white. And as time went on, I did lots of coloring in school, but, when I became a professional, I started off in black and white because I was born in the UK, raised in Nigeria, and then I had my education in America, and I've been in the UK for over 30 years. So I've had a wealth of experience of drawing cartoons and switching from black and white to color. So having a look at that, you have an idea of what it takes to be a cartoonist. Sometimes I may jump into bed and an idea comes to me, get out of bed again, go into the computer or go onto my notepad and write down my ideas. Because if you don't write down your ideas, you will never ever get those ideas again. So it's always good to jot down notes of what your visuals are, what your thoughts are. You can always revisit them at your own, during your own convenience, okay? So I'll go to the next one, which is this. And this one I like because my son did a pencil of, while he admired, he enjoyed my cartoon, so he did a pencil of a drawing while he was at school. And I developed that into a character. Now, if you look at the face of this cartoon character here, whom he called Afro Joe with a pick in his hair, called Afro Joe. Now, you see the eyes of Afro Joe are shaped like eggs, the shape of eggs. And the mouth is half moon as well. And the hair, if you go around it, is round, oval or round in shape or circular in shape. So shapes are very important to drawing cartoons. So my son doing that, I developed that drawing into the color that's seen now. Okay. So let's go to the next page. I just jumped ahead of Black History Month in the United Kingdom. It's all about celebrating black heroes and promoting black history. I began drawing our roots in the United Kingdom in 1989, the Voice newspaper, one of Britain's biggest black newspaper in the United Kingdom. And from there, I began drawing in black and white. And from there, I developed developed the interest in drawing black heroes, not just in the US, not just in the UK, but all around the world in diaspora. And that's what I'm all about. Oprah Winfrey, whom many of you would know, one of the richest black presenters on telly, said, "Excellence is the best deterrent to racism and sexism. Excellence is the best deterrent to racism and sexism. If you do well in what you do, people will always want to work with you." And I've been able to experience that through my career years. I've really, really been doing very good works and been excelling what I do, that there's always a demand for me to do some more work for other organizations. Okay, I'm gonna click on that. History dies without the present. There is no future without a path made to it by the past. In other words, without a past, there cannot be a present and there cannot be a future. The past and the present shapes the future. And you, as perhaps the young ones watching this, you are the future. And you need to make your future start working for you now. That's very important. Okay? Now, this is a school I went to, the Cubitt School of Cartoonographic, my humble beginning of drawing cartoons. I was doing cartoons in Nigeria, and I went to the US to better myself in drawing cartoons. So you will see there's always a need to reference the school I went to for you to have an idea that I just didn't draw for drawing's sake. I also developed the skill in drawing cartoons by having a good education at the school and teaching, learning cartoons as well, all right? And I learned a lot there, animation, caricatures, human anatomy, narrative art, lettering, comic books. It's a fun school to go to. And you have some of my best years, should I say, was at this school with friends who are now all around the world, and we're still in contact with each other. And this is the drawing, African Sketchbook. This is the drawing I did at the school, the Cubitt School. It was originally called African Sketchbook because after my education, I was thinking of going back to Africa, to Nigeria, to draw on the achievements of Africans, because I thought there was the need for Africans to be recognized for their achievements as well. Because when I was in America, it was all about African-American heroes. And I thought to myself, as a Nigerian, I needed to highlight and showcase African heroes, places, events, and things in Africa as an African. And I was drawing from an African perspective. So this was the first format of our roots, my drawing on black history. And I must say that this was the first time I got an A plus at the school, because my teachers found it being original. Like I said, we're celebrating Black History in the United Kingdom. And here is the first member of parliament, first Black member of parliament in the United Kingdom. Her name is Diane Abbott. So the first female Black MP in the United Kingdom is Diane Abbott. Now, what I do drawings. I do drawings to one side of the panel of my roots, and then write a little bit of information about the person, people or places I'm featuring my roots. But I do have to do, I do lots of reading for you to be able to, for me to be able to summarize this in some few, in about 50 to 60 to 70 words for you to, for people to read. And what our roots does is it enables people to make further research about whichever personality I feature in my drawings. Okay. And here's the first Black professional soccer player in the United Kingdom as well. Bear with me, because since I'm in the United Kingdom and we're celebrating Black History Month, it's important for you to know other Black heroes you've never heard of. And you can do further research on these people as I go along. There's more to come. And take notice of the drawings in black and white. That's how I started our roots. It later went into color. And also, here's another one on the publisher of Britain's biggest newspaper, the Voice newspaper, of course, in the United Kingdom, called Varmakala. He gave me the opportunity to publish our roots. See how African sketchbook has now become our roots, because when I was when I relocated to the United Kingdom, I decided to do features on people all around the world. So I decided to change the title, from African sketchbook to our roots, which embraces Black people in diaspora. And more of our roots in black and white. It just got better, because when you're drawing and you're encouraged by publications, you're encouraged even by the Smithsonian Natural Museum of African Art, giving this platform to be able to showcase your work. You encourage and you want to do more and want to better yourself in the drawing. Okay. And here's another one of my black and white drawings as well. Trevor MacDonald, the first Black television newscaster in the United Kingdom. Okay. And there we are, a popular trade union leader called Bill Morris, United Kingdom as well. So you'll be wondering that, why do you have lots of Black Britons there? Because again, we're celebrating Black heroes in the United Kingdom. And for many of you who may not know that we celebrate Black History Month in the United Kingdom, this is an opportunity for you to know about Black heroes in Europe, in the United Kingdom, in Africa, in South America, in the Caribbean, all around the world. Okay. Now it gets better. You will notice this drawing to publicize this workshop, and that's when I started becoming conscious of having my work in color. So it just got better from black and white, as you can see. It went from black and white, if I can go back to black and white, to color. There's a vast difference there. Because it's the age of digital art, and I had to move at times to improve on my work, and also to ensure that my work is accessible everywhere, all around the world. So these are my drawings. Africa's first bobsled team actually came from Nigeria. And here they are. The fact that they actually featured in the competition is an achievement. And it will just get better, because they were encouraged by so many to be at the Olympics. And Africa's first bobsled team to feature in the Olympics, the Winter Olympics. Okay? And here's Thomas Green, who was born blind, autistic, but he was a genius in playing the piano. And you can see, so what I do with our roots is let people know that there was more to, I wouldn't say there's more, but some of you will know Stevie Wonder, more like the present. And here's the past, which is on the screen. And I'm sure there's a future coming along. But not only was Thomas Wiggins blind, like I said, he was autistic and a very, very good pianist. And he made money from his master's then. And he actually was the first African American to perform at the White House. And he performed a famous song called The Battle of Manassas. Okay. Black Lives Matter, as you can see there. So I tend to make research on whatever I want to draw and then give people an idea of what information I want to put out there. So you see that my range goes from various Black achievers from around the world. Also, you recognize that I use a comic book font. That's intentional. The comic book style of lettering is intentional because many are into comic books, and I thought having my drawings done with comic book font would give many the impression of a comic book I want to read. That was the intention, to use a comic book font to letter my drawings. Because we studied that when I was at school, I studied lettering as well. So we did comic book lettering. That's what we had to do. It was a class just for lettering. Because not only can you be a cartoonist or comic artist or colorist or penciler or inker, you could also be a colorist, or you could also be a letterer and letter your own works as well. Okay. And here's another courageous Mary Prince, was born a slave in the Caribbean in 1788 on a plantation in Bermuda. So again, another Black heroine featured in our roots. Windrush arrivals, and on June 22nd, 1948, the MV Windrush docked at Tilbury and changed the face of British history forever with the first mass Black migration to Britain. It's called Windrush and is celebrated every year because Black people from the Caribbean actually contributed to British history, and that cannot be wished away. And here's another Black Briton, originally from a Somalian from Somaliland, and he was one of the first Somali settlers in London, United Kingdom. Okay, here are extracts from my new book on Black History, Our Roots, which was published in a magazine called New African Magazine. So these are extracts from my drawings on my new book called Our Roots, Volume 2. I've got Volume 1 done in black and white, but I've got Volume 2 done in color. Again, I used the opportunity of the lockdown to work on this project, and it's been an exciting period for me to do this work in color. I had fun doing it, and you can see the outcome of it. And there is more to the excerpts in the book than what you see here. These are just like what they are, just bits and bobs of what's in the book, but more elaborate in the book. And that's another page in New African Magazine that features our roots, more or less publicizing our roots in the new book. And hopefully you get to pick up your copies or buy a copy when it gets to Smithsonian eventually. Okay, there you are. And I usually draw for this paper. This was the first paper. This was paper in the UK to give me the opportunity to publish our roots. So I published, I've been with them for over 30 years, drawing our roots in this paper. But since then, our roots has gone all around the world. Let me go back to that again, just for you to have a look at that. This was an important case about a legacy about Stephen Lawrence in the United Kingdom, who was killed by racists, but it was a big story then. They never caught the killers, but they changed the family. This family, the Lawrence family, changed the face of Britain forever. And go to the next one, another Black Briton, which is Britain's first well-known Black stand-up comedian and singer to experience mainstream success on television. His name, Charlie Williams. You probably will see him in the animation I'm going to show you shortly. Again, Baroness Patricia Scotland of Ashton, a British barrister, is the first Black female in UK's House of Lords. She also made history in 1999 by being Britain's first Black minister in Prime Minister Tony Blair's government. So I tend to read and write about these Black heroes and achievers. And also I have here Sam Beaver King, was the first Black mayor of London Borough of Southwark in South East London as well. Same thing. Oops, let me go back again. There you go. King Subhuza II of Swaziland was the longest reigning monarch in Africa. And I usually feature lots of African heroes, achievers, and unsung heroes mostly, so people are aware of these people other than the well-known political, musical, and educational heroes we have in Africa as well. Okay. And Lewis Hamilton, some of you are into Formula One, in the racing circuit, you know that Steve Lewis Hamilton is the first Black driver to race in Formula One and also the first Black driver to race for Britain in Formula One. He's won 7 championships now. I'm aiming for the 8th, but winning 7 alone is an achievement by any standard. And he used his skills, he used his gift in driving to overcome racism and bullying. Okay? And he was used also at the back of the newspaper I draw for, the Voice newspaper, on the sports page when he won his 7th championship. It was put at the back. My image was put at the back of the sports newspaper, on the back page of the sports paper, on the sports page newspaper. What should I say? Back of the Voice newspaper sports page. Okay, got that right in the end. Okay, I got Mary Prince there again. So, and we also have Toni Morrison. I did this for newsella.com, a website for teachers and students as well. And I've always been an admirer of Toni Morrison's work. And it's nice to see. What's good about our roots is that not only do I write about them, I enjoy drawing them. Sometimes I take drawings in black and white and turn them into color. So sometimes some images of people you've seen in black and white, I may end up being the first person to have them drawn in color, because some black and white pictures probably way before color was in operation. Then color images was in operation. So I really enjoy that. You can see that was the first Black president of the US, Barack Obama, presenting her with a Medal of Freedom in 2012. Okay, so Anthony Joshua, Nigerian by heritage, and a well-known boxer who won a few titles. He lost them recently. I'm sure he'll bounce back again. But the fact, one thing is that just like Muhammad Ali, no matter, even when Muhammad Ali, when he got older, began to lose matches, but it did not take away from the fact that he still remains the greatest. And that's the same with Anthony Joshua. He's done well for himself. And these are role models to young, up-and-coming Black Britons who want to go into boxing. Could be in boxing, could be on TV, could be in sports. But without role models, it's difficult to know what direction you want for yourself. So as an artist, you must have a role model. I was mentored by Joe Kubert, the proprietor of the school, Kubert School, and also by Jerry Robinson, the creator of The Joker. he syndicated my art. He was the first to syndicate my art in America. And right now, our roots has been published in the New York, Amsterdam News, Sacramento Observer, and also Miami News, I believe, and also some other publications all around the US. And you can find our roots on the website. It's an award-winning feature as well. I won an award for this drawing, for drawings on Black history, a couple of years back in Philadelphia. I had to fly to Philadelphia to pick up my award for these drawings by ECBACC, the organizers of the award in Philadelphia. Okay, so also the Jamaican parentage. He was born Delroy Lindo, born of Jamaican parentage and a Hollywood actor. Some of you might say Delroy Lindo in some of the movies, Hollywood movies, but he was actually born in Southeast London, and then raised in Lewisham, which also is in Southeast London as well. And then William Coffey, again, good boy with that. And sorting of Sokoto, my images, I just don't write, I just don't read. I also draw to inspire young artists to know how to draw, to know how to color, because that's very important if you want to make any headway in drawing cartoons, in drawing comics, and illustrating works given to you by clients as well. And also, I have more Black Britons there. And here is Samuel Coleridge Taylor, who was one of Britain's most classical composers. His great composition, Hiawatha's Wedding Feast, written in 1898, was a most famed choral work of his. That's Samuel Coleridge Taylor. And I hope you're taking down notes as we go along. Take down notes of these names and find out more about their achievements and what they have achieved whilst they were around, or the achievements of those in the past, the achievements of those in the present, and the achievements of those in the future, who still have a long way to go to have more achievements in their name. Okay, so that's that. And remember that name, Samuel Coleridge Taylor. And we have here and Claude McKay, but you see him in the animation. So I'm just showing you my work in color now, for starting with my work, first of all, in black and white, but now in color. Okay. And here's a guy that has designed almost 90% of Fela Kuti's album, Bob Marley introduced reggae to the world, so did Fela introduce Afrobeat to the world. But this guy, Gary Kulemi, designed most of Fela's albums, about 26 of them. So his album covers were always something I needed to look out for, to see what album cover he would do next for Fela as well. Okay, so that's Gary Kulemi. So right here, drawing our roots, I'm going to show you how I go about drawing our roots. I made it as quick as possible, so you just bear with me and just see how I do our roots. Now, when I do our roots, I usually draw our roots with a panel like that, okay? And when I draw our roots, I first draw in pencil, okay? That's a panel, that's a pencil. And then I put my logo there, our roots. And then after that, I add color to it, okay? I add color to the work, and then when I add color to it, I ensure that there's space enough there to add my text. So anytime you're drawing, even in comic books, when comic book artists, when they draw, they're always thinking of where to put captions in their drawings. And you should always do that. Don't fill the page with beautiful drawings and the captions then go over those beautiful drawings. So here we are again. I'm going to show you. Let me just repeat that again. Remember what I said? First of all, draw in pencils to get it right. Then when you're drawing pencils to get it right, you go start adding other things to it. Like I added the logo, then I added color to it. Like I said, that's the fun bit. And I color on computers using Adobe Photoshop, Illustrator, or Microsoft Paint as well. And that's where it takes you. And that's the final. And the final bit is to then add text to it, the name of the person you've drawn, and their achievements. Okay, there you go. And because of our roots, I've been able to do so many drawings in the UK. I'm always getting people come to me, or organizations or clients come to me saying, we like your drawings on Black history, and we want you to do something for us. This is a drawing I did for Birmingham Council in the Midlands in England, about allotments, okay? This is because of our roots. And you also have the Oba of Benin. These I did for British. I did about 10 illustrations for the British Museum. And this is the Benin Kingdom. Okay. We have the Mali Kingdom, the Benin Kingdom, the Kush Kingdom, the Zimbabwe Kingdom. I did about 10 different African kingdoms for the British Museum. And this is the Benin Kingdom. And you can see the Benin Kingdom. And all I had to work with were these artifacts from Africa, from Nigeria, most of them from Nigeria. And I was shown this display. These were all displayed in the museum, and I had to come up with a story to create a story around these images. And this is how I came up, because these and the Oba of Benin and the Benin Kingdom in those days was the era of slavery. And that's why you see slave trade going on in the background there to the slave masters who came to Africa to look around for, shop for slaves. And they always give the king, Oba of Benin, the king, a few gifts to excite them about giving away slaves to them as well. Unfortunately, but that's what happened. That's part of history, which cannot be wished away. And the other kingdom is the Mali Kingdom, also for the British Museum. And you can see there, these are all I got, tablets, Arabic tablets, to work with. And I came up with a whole of this visual you now see on the page. I had to research how the houses were in those days, mud houses, what sort of dress they wore, what sort of food they sold, what sort of clothes they sold in markets. And so the whole concept was built around just being shown these two tablets these men are holding in their hands, in which they used to teach Arabic or read Arabic, okay? And because of our roots, BBC commissioned me to do a digital comic feature on called Hooked on a small country in West Africa. So it was, I had a fun time doing Hooked, which was 6 minutes. It was a six minute video, but it took me 2 to 3 months to complete the digital work. It's not easy with animation. It's quicker to draw, or should I say, animation is time consuming. So don't expect to draw, to do or finish animation in one week or 2 weeks. Animation that you may do can take 4 months, 5 months, depending on how much input has gone into it. So animation does take time. And when I had an animation training at the Cubitt School, it took us a whole year to do a rabbit character called Mr. Popularity. Because some of us had to paint the background for the character, some of us had to draw the character itself, and some of us had to do the in-betweens from moving from A to B. We had to do the in-betweens of the storyline, all for 5 minutes, but it took a long time to do that. Okay. And this is what I did for New York Amsterdam News when Obama became the first Black president of America. I did a comic page for New York Amsterdam News. And so not only do I do cartoons, illustrations, I also do comic pages as well, depending on who wants me to do it for them, unless I go out of my way to look for funding for my own project. But people come along, they have ideas, but they don't know how to put it down on paper or execute it. So that's why I come in to with my skills that I've acquired through the years and my experience to do a comic for them as well. Okay. And that's the first book on Black History called Our Roots that I did about 20 years ago. But in between the 20 years and now, I've updated the book itself. But Black history will always be there. For as long as there's the black race, there will always be a black history. Black history, black achievers have contributed a lot to global history. So that we cannot put to one side. We can never ever wish it away. Okay. And that's the cover of my new book, Our Roots on Black History. Again, now in full color, I was able to do great works doing this in full color. Okay, and sit back and relax and enjoy the video in which you're going to see, you know, the animation I did for about 5 months, and enjoy watching it while the technical department plays my animation, Our Roots, Black History in Motion. Our Roots. Black History in Motion. UK Prime Minister Sir Winston Churchill's "If We Must Die" speech before Parliament in the 1940s, in which he issued a rallying cry for Britain to go to war against Hitler's Nazi Germany, belongs to Jamaican-born poet, writer, and journalist Claude McKay, 1889 to 1948. Charlie Williams, 1927 to 2006. Williams was Britain's first well-known black stand-up comedian to experience mainstream success. He was also one of the first black football players in British football. Dr. Ameyo Stella Adadevo, a physician and a heroine. Dr. Adadevo is credited with stopping the wider spread of the Ebola virus in Nigeria in the year 2014, a fight she herself succumbed to. To many Nigerians, Dr. Adadevo remains a heroine. The West Indian Gazette, the first major newspaper for black people in Britain, was started by Claudia Jones. Jones was born in 1915, and she's best remembered as the mother of the Notting Hill Carnival in London, which she founded in 1959. She died in 1964, preceded by Queen Elizabeth II, one of the most remarkable personalities in Africa, happens to be Pan-Africanist Dr. Kwame Nkrumah, 1909 to 1972. In 1960, Dr. Nkrumah led his nation to become the first Prime Minister of Independence Ghana in West Africa. With a unique style of flawless jazz singing, African-American jazz great Sarah Vaughan, 1924 to 1990, never ever sang a note twice. John Richard Archer, 1863 to 1932, was Britain's first black mayor in London in 1913. He was also the first to write a constitution to obtain black voting rights in Britain.
Nelson Mandela, 1918 to 2013, was the first black president of independent South Africa. He said,
"Education is the most powerful weapon in which you can use to change the world."
Under apartheid, Nelson Mandela's prison number was 46664. In the early 1960s, U.S. civil rights activist Dr. Martin Luther King Jr., 1929 to 1968, led crowds of African Americans to Selma in the state of Alabama. This march was Dr. King's effort to get everyone to protest about the inequality of voting in the state and to have African Americans registered to vote. The protest march did not go unnoticed. Moira Stewart was the BBC's first black female newscaster in 2001. She was awarded an OBE for services to broadcasting in the Queen's Birthday Honours. Born in 1973, Harry Russell Mack, at the age of 33, made history by becoming the first black presenter of a primetime mainstream news program as a news anchor man in France. This was on the 17th of July, 2006. A sporting and cultural icon, a record breaker, an activist, and a legend, Lewis Hamilton, born in 1985, is the first black driver to race in Formula One. He is also the first black driver to race for Britain. He has experienced bullying and racism and has excelled to overcome discouragement.
Tayo, that was amazing. Amazing presentation. Thank you. Thank you.
Thank you.
Wow. Okay, let's have a conversation because there's so much I want to, you know, talk about. I mean, there's so much there. I guess you can start out talking about your drawing routine. Like, how often do you draw, you know, and how many hours per day? Okay. And, you know, how do you break that up?
I'm always drawing. I could easily say I'm always drawing in my sleep as well.
Okay.
I just love drawing, and I think through the years, I've been so much encouraged that I couldn't see myself doing anything else but draw. Mm-hmm. And as years has gone by, I've realized that the importance of drawing, and it's been a gift in me, and I couldn't do anything else other than draw. And that has been that's been my career all along. So I really enjoy drawing, and it depends on what I'm doing, because I can multitask as well in terms of being creative. I could be painting 1 hour, the next hour I'm illustrating, the third hour I'm designing. So it just depends. But what matters a lot is what I learned at school, at the keyboard school, is that no matter how good or how bad you are, you should always meet your deadlines, and I always do that a lot, trying to ensure that I meet my deadlines. So I prioritize my work depending on which one is meant to be to meet its deadline first before I go on to another one as well.
Mm-hmm. Wow. I mean, so like, how much revision and editing do you do of your work? Because like, do you write a script or make up a drawing as you go along? Because I know you showed us a little bit of the blueprint beginning, yeah, what you do, mm-hmm, but you do a lot of editing and revision.
I do lots of reading as well, because sometimes I can read a whole book to summarize in about 50 to 70 words what I've read in the book, or what's important in the book, or what's important in our roots, our date. Dates matter to me, because people can reference my drawings to be able to, on online or in books, to be able to find out more information. I've got students from universities or colleges asking me where I got my information from, because they want to make more further research on the particular person I've drawn. So I do the research, and at the right time, I then decide to draw them, because like I said, I'm an artist of African diaspora, so I don't particularly just draw people from Nigeria or people from the Caribbean or people from America. I make sure that I balance my drawings, and when they're out there, they're balanced, they're well balanced enough to cater for everyone and represent everyone represented in the Black race.
Amazing. And so, you know, I was going to ask you about the books you've read, because I wasn't sure if you read nonfiction or what types of books you read. But what type of comics or cartoons do you enjoy?
I love comics. I like different formats of comics. I wouldn't say I'm particularly I have a favorite publication, but what tends to come out of my reading comics, like superheroes, like graphic novels, which are most times true to life, like Persepolis or Palestine, or those graphic novels are usually true to life stories, and I really enjoy those ones as well. So I read lots of comic books, and it just depends on what's of interest to me at the moment. But they tend to vary, so I don't particularly have one particular comic book I'm stuck with.
Wow. Well, we just have a quick question. It's on screen. Tayo, you got any tips for drawing people?
Yeah. When you're drawing cartoons, no matter what you're drawing, you must have, like I did again, I have to refer to my school, which everyone should know, that you must understand the human figure. You must be able to know how to draw people. And when you do, we had life drawings in classes at school as well, where we had to draw models to see the features and how features of the face, the arms, the legs. So these drawing, being conscious of the human anatomy matters in drawing cartoons. And you can also get books on drawing people as well from libraries or from bookshops as well, or from the internet. But you have to practice. The more you practice, the better you are in drawing. And that's very helpful tip for you.
I'm curious, what other types of art forms do you enjoy, like mixed media, photography, sculpture, stuff like that?
I like digital art a lot. I like sculptures as well. I like paintings as well. I do painting as well. But they just vary. Sometimes I can come across a project that require what I've never done before, but I just explore the possibility of finishing that project off and finding out how I can get someone else who is a master in a particular field to assist me in bringing this project together. So it just depends on what I like. but all I know is that whatever comes my way is what I just deal with them as they come, because you must be a professional. That's very important.
Sure.
Very important.
Yeah. I mean, as a child, did you watch a lot of cartoons, and did you read a lot of comic books as a child?
I did. I watched lots of animated cartoons, animation. And my parents, my mom in particular, encouraged me with drawing cartoons because she was a nurse at the hospital in Lagos, and she would come home with comic books from Britain or comic books from America. So I was intrigued into drawing cartoons right from when I was very young. In fact, I so much loved cartoons that when I was in secondary school, I would draw my own comic book and I would get students, my fellow students, to pay to read my comics. So I was very much into comics when I was very young. And when I was in school, I came across the first superhero I ever came across was the Mighty Thor. And I said, wow, that's a character that can fly. And since then, I've not looked back, knowing fully well that you can do anything believable in cartoons or with cartoons.
Sure. Yeah. That's amazing. And what artists do you feel a kinship with that you really admire? Artists today?
There's one, a good friend of mine, Murak Oguntade. I like working with him. I also like working with Tor Bright from Cameroon as well, and a few others, but I can't, the names that come to me straight away is Morak and Tor, and they're very good artists. But I do work with various artists as well, the young and the older ones as well. And the younger artists or the up and coming artists are always eager to work with me and to know the trade as well. So it's an experience for them to work with me. So I work with anyone who's ready to work with me.
So is having a community of African-centered artists important to you?
It's very important because it's a form of networking as well. And for instance, we have the Cartoonist Association of Nigeria, whereby we always we can have our banter on our WhatsApp forum, and we can share cartoons, comics, projects together. And so that is always ongoing. But with the ones I in particular, then we also have Cartooning for Peace as well, that has arranged African cartoonists coming together in Addis Ababa in Ethiopia at the World Press Freedom Day to showcase our works and talk about press freedom and press freedom in press freedom in cartoons as well. Amazing. So that's that. Yeah.
So what is more important to you, style or idea, or neither?
Both
style, yes. Idea. Yes. I was watching, I was looking at, you know, at all of the images of the diaspora, because you covered the Caribbean, you covered UK, you covered America, you covered Africa. Mm-hmm. So your objective in your art is historically centered. Mm-hmm. You use comparative arts because you successfully juxtapose a very popular art form, which is cartoons, sort of the gravel approach. Mm. With historical context. Now, why do you feel your cartoons are relevant today, right now?
I think they're relevant today because, especially with our roots, they're very educational. And they're more like a cartoon, and documenting history through my cartoons. I must say I was inspired by Ripley's Believe It or Not when I was schooling in America. That encouraged me to do cartoon documentary on Black history when I decided to go back to Nigeria after my education in America. So that's where I am with that, and I keep doing that from time to time to enjoy documenting. I also do editorial cartoons as well, like political cartoons. I cartoon issues like AIDS, poverty, famine, you name it. So because, like I said in my earlier on, that my drawings, cartoons can speak volumes as well than when you write down something. In Africa, in some remote places in Africa, images speak volumes. When it comes to vaccination, images speak volume, and that's very essential to. That's very important when it comes to passing across a message
and you want to make sure that the whole of the country understands the message you're putting across. So visuals are very important in terms of communication, because we all speak different languages. I've been to various countries of different languages, but one language that we all speak together is usually cartoons and comics. And we all understand each other through drawing cartoons and comics.
That is very true. And we see that with the popularity of graphic novels today.
Correct. Yeah.
You know, you mentioned, you know, your global exposure. You've lived on three continents, and your art celebrates the African diaspora. So what do you want people to understand about the African diaspora and the importance of focusing on it?
I think what's important is for people to know others, the unsung heroes and heroines, and that's very important, because it grieves me if one particular person takes all the glory for those who had paved the way for him or her to take and to achieve what him or her have achieved. So I tend to focus on unsung heroes, and I do my research on unsung heroes. There's so many unsung heroes out there, you will not believe it. I've done so many drawings on blackish, so many black heroes. I've not even put them out there yet, but I've drawn them. I remember when I was at the National Cartoonist Convention in Jersey City, in the US, of course. I was at the platform at a subway station, and I saw across the platform a big advert sign saying the first person, the person to design the ice cream scoop was a black man. I said, wow, I never knew that. So I took my notes. Wherever I travel to, I'm always jotting down notes, taking notes down, to ensure that when I get back to my drawing board, I'm able to put this information out there. Information is very important, especially not fake news, but genuine news that information that will benefit the young ones and also make the young black enthusiasts, and enthusiasts of black history want to feel that they can be achievers as well. And if I'm being a role model to many helps, then I know I've achieved something myself, and that's very important.
Sure, that is so true. And you mentioning unsung heroes, unsung stories, so many of them. You see yourself sort of looking out for and researching a lot of those unsung heroes that we know nothing about. Do you see that you're doing more of that?
I'm always on the lookout. I don't go out of my way to look for unsung heroes, but I'm always on the lookout for them, because you never can tell where they can come from. They could be on the TV that no one's paid attention to, in newspapers. I have a friend, Evie, from in Philadelphia, sent me a cutting of a horse rider in Philadelphia, New Jersey, and she sent it to me that, hey Tayo, would you like to do something about do our roots on this person and I said, oh wow, that's interesting. I never heard of this person before. I forgot him. Sullivan Davis, who was a horse rider in New Jersey, and he was always teaching children how to ride horses. And I thought to myself that he needs to be mentioned. We also have a UK weightlifter who was never ever given credit for what he did in the UK. His name was George Newington, and I was able to mention him as well. So what I do is I keep records of information that I've got, and at the appropriate time, I illustrate them. Well, I must have the information, enough information to go with them before I put them out there or publish them.
Well, you know, let's talk a little bit about the contributions of people of African and Caribbean descent in the UK. Do you think that we'll see and read more stories of these contributions in the future? Because now people are really, there's an interest, and a lot of that interest comes from now there's more of a presence that we see in pop culture. African of British descent, who we see on screen, we see in film, we see in television shows. Mm-hmm. Do you think that, you know, we'll see and read more stories of these contributions in the future?
We will definitely. You mean from the UK? Is that what you're saying?
UK, from the UK.
Definitely, because UK, I believe, is at the forefront of celebrating Black history in Europe, and I believe we've come a long way in the UK, and there's also a travel guide on Black London, places of interest, and where Black achievers have done quite a lot in London, and which was published by a good friend of mine, co-authored by Jody Burton as well. So we've come a long way, and where we are now, especially on the back of Black Lives Matter, there's more awareness of Black history, and people wanting to educate about Black history and the achievers as well, and not necessarily the negative aspect of it, but mostly the successful and important aspects of Black history is what we share with one another in the UK. So Black history celebration in the UK is gone places where it's never gone before, and I'm happy about it, because when I started drawing our roots and I came to the United Kingdom in 1989, I wasn't aware of Black History Month. I wasn't aware of Black History Month even when I was schooling in America. But fortunately, when I was in the UK, I decided I wanted to do our roots in the Voice newspaper. And then that was later on, I found out there was an event called Black History Month. So it just, the lines just fell into place for me. It was so perfect for me to now write on the back of a Black History Month to showcase my work, our roots on Black history. So we're doing fine in the UK, but it's also nice for everyone else around the world to know that, just like in America, that we also celebrate Black History Month in the UK, and also in Canada, I believe, as well.
You know, there are so many stories about the migration that took place, I believe, in the 1940s up till the early 1960s. The migration from Africa and the Caribbean, almost 5 million migrated to the UK during that time period. Those stories are interesting.
Yeah.
Stories are important. And, you know, I think that all of us would be interested in hearing about that specific period in time of those stories that people could talk about moving from their home country to the UK and what they were feeling and what it was like raising a family, raising generations.
Yeah.
You know, those stories are very important. So we kind of look forward.
Yeah, they're very important. We are like we said, we had the Windrush arrivant, so came to the UK in 1948 from Caribbean, and we have the Somalis who settled here many years back as well from Somaliland as well, and wherever you look around the UK, you find out that black people have black Britons have contributed a lot to the society. Educationally and politically and socially, they've done quite a lot, and we're going places. And I think that there's more that we can do, and we're just there. And like I said, we cannot wish away the fact that blacks who came to set in the UK actually have contributed a lot to the community in the UK as well.
Exactly. So, you know, when did you realize you had a passion for art? Was it when you were in grade school?
I was very young. I don't know what's grade school? What age is grade school? I've forgotten now.
Okay. Maybe ages 6 to 11.
Grade school. We call it, in Nigeria, it's called
elementary school.
In Nigeria, it's called primary school. So it was when I was in grade school, primary school, that I showed interest. I think what moved me was seeing a Marvel comic, like I said, the pocketbook of Mighty Thor, the superhero. I said, "Wow, I've got to draw this guy as well. I've got to learn how to draw superheroes as well." Even though I don't draw superheroes, I did that when I was in school, but I just enjoyed drawing when I was in primary school, grade school, and I really enjoyed that, and I've never looked back. In fact, my parents were not happy that I was always drawing. My parents wanted me to be a doctor or a lawyer or some high profession. And now everyone's finding out that art is very rewarding as well. I mean, they were almost begging me to do something other than drawing. But I stuck to my guns, and they supported me ever since. And my family has supported me ever since. Even my siblings have supported me ever since. I'm so happy that I was determined. But you must be determined to whatever you're determined to do is very good. But you also must have a good education and a good plan B. I always tell children when I go to do workshops in schools, museums, and libraries that they must have plan B. And plan B is to have a good education. That matters a lot. So no matter how good I was in drawing, I wanted a plan B. And that's why I went to the US to learn how to draw cartoons and have a good and better education and be able to communicate very well with the rest of the world.
But you also read a lot of books when you were younger. Did you read a lot of books?
I did. I was more into you could say comic books. Comic books.
That's
well, I had to read books. I had to read books to pass my exams, definitely.
Of course, nonfiction. Okay,
yeah, but that's important to all the young ones listening to this.
Yes.
When you must, it's good to read. I always say to children, it's good to read. But as I got older, I just went into reading comic books, and that's what I've always been doing. I like reading newspapers and magazines. Yeah. I like being conscious of what's going on around me, because we cannot afford to be ignorant of what's going on around us. We must know that. So I like to be well informed. So I listen to TV news programs a lot to find out. And these news programs can also inspire me to draw editorial cartoons as well, or to find out someone new that I would like to put in our roots.
Yeah, I really enjoyed the diversity of your presentation of comics, because it's a mixture of being socially conscious. You've got some entertainment in there. You've got some sports. You've got a little politics. You've got some religion. You've got a lot of history.
Mm-hmm.
So having just that diversity is so, so very important, I believe.
Very, very important. Yeah.
And it says a lot about your experiences. Mm-hmm. I wanted to kind of go back to you living on three continents and having that exposure. Did living on three different continents cultivate you in any way as an artist and as a writer?
Yeah, it made me realize that the world is very small, and I really enjoyed. I think while I was at school in the US, I feel blessed to have traveled out of Nigeria to school in America, because that way I was able to meet people of various diverse backgrounds as well, and appreciate people as well. I mean, I'm the type that appreciates everyone, no matter the color, no matter the race, no matter the creed, no matter the gender. I appreciate everyone, and that's very important when you have a broader mind, you're able to understand people better than if you're cocooned in your particular place you live in or the country you live in. But we see that those who are vast in the area of being knowledgeable are those who have been exposed to the outer world and have been around the world and are able to understand the culture, the tradition, or traditions of various people all around the world. And that's very important as well. And also to appreciate other people's culture. And as well. That's why when I travel to events or cartoon festivals, when I'm invited to cartoon festivals or comic conventions in various countries that I go to, I don't go close to McDonald's. I'd rather try out what they eat in that country. Right. And that's very important, because I want to be part of that community. I want to be part of that society. For the period I'm there, for the period I'm visiting that country, I want to be part of that society as well.
And to absorb it. And so it's so interesting, because many artists do find their muses globally, and their inspirations come from all different parts, you know, of the globe. But what I find is interesting is you as an artist, you have a lot of stories. So what other stories are you interested in creating art for? What stories really interest you?
I still want to do more educational stories. And I think educational stories can have a longer lifespan on bookshelves. I want to use my work to educate as many as possible. So I still want to do more of animation. I even want to improve on what I did, because if it wasn't for lockdown, I probably wouldn't have thought of animation. I was thinking of how do I reach out to everyone out there through my work, because before we had a lockdown in the UK, I would go to schools and do workshops, but that wasn't the case for over a year until I went back recently. And whilst we were in the lockdown, I was thinking of other ways to reach out to people. And then I had to embrace digital technology and the technology that goes with digital, and having been on social media as well and using webinars as well. I did quite a lot of that during the lockdown, and I've just got better. And now I'm not looking back again, because I want to do more of digital work. So I'm being on webinars and online. I'm being able to reach remote places of this world that only you can reach through the social media or the internet.
That's so true. And, you know, I have to honestly comment, I loved your short film. I really did. You know, do you see more films, you doing more films in the future?
I hope so. The main reason for this is for everyone to know what I do or what I can do.
Yes.
And this is just the beginning. This animation reminds me of when I first started Our Roots. It will get better.
Yes. Yes.
And I'm already planning the second series already.
Okay. No, we definitely are looking forward to that. But yeah. I definitely see maybe film in the future, and that's really exciting.
Yeah.
What advice would you give to your younger self?
Well, the only advice is I can give to the younger self is that you should have aspirations. That's very important. Mm-hmm. You should look up to good mentors to mentor you in whatever you want to be. I always say to children as well in my workshops, if you want to be a footballer, you must learn how to play football, and you must have a mentor. When I was very young, I had mentors. I had a Nigerian, my Nigerian cartoonist like Kenny Adamson was my mentor. Tunde Okusi was my mentor in Nigeria. And I had Joe Kubert, I had Jerry Robinson. I always had mentors that I visited and looked up to better myself in drawing cartoons as well. So for the young ones, education
is the most powerful weapon in which you can use to change the world.
Education is very important. Education. And when you have your good education, other things will fall into place. Whatever you want to be in life, it will fall into place. But you must have a good education. Because without education, how do you want to communicate? Without education, how do you want to better yourself? Without education, how do you want to meet with the right people? Education matters. Without education, how do you want to be knowledgeable about the world? Because when people are not knowledgeable about the world, then they find themselves, again, like I said, cocooned in a particular area, and this brings about racism, this brings about bullying and other negative issues that should not be around at all. But once you have a good education, and once you're able to appreciate the person next to you, then the sky's the limit for you. But you have to put all your effort to do well.
Yeah, you're exactly right, because art is a reflection of the artist's reality, the artist's own experience. So education is a very important part. You'll communicate more effectively, I think. Rachel. And so thanks for mentioning education. So like, what is the greatest thing about being an artist?
Being loved, my work being loved, being appreciated. And my work has been so much loved that I wouldn't exchange it for anything else. And because I've been encouraged through the years, I just get better in what I do. As you get older, you get better as well. As we get older, we learn as well. When I was drawing cartoons, there wasn't anything like digital art, but I had to embrace that to be able to reinvent what I do and move with times so that times will not leave me behind. And that matters a lot. So I'm glad. Most importantly, I thank God for giving me this wonderful gift to share with the world. I'm happy about that.
It's beautiful. And so is there any specific advice that you could give to very young artists or someone who wants to pursue art as a career?
Yeah, I think the most important thing is to, first of all, depending on how young you are, it matters that you should join organizations. You should join organizations and have a network of organizations you can join. I am a member of Cartooning for Peace, Cartoonist Association of Nigeria, CARTEN, Cartoon Arts International, Kegel.com, politicalcartoons.com. So I'm out there wanting everyone to know what I do. And it's good to join organizations as well. I also joined the ECBACC, ECBA, in Philadelphia for the Black artists. This organization has been very good in encouraging Black artists to draw cartoons as well. Led by the president, Yumi Odom. So it's very important to remain focused on what you want to do. Don't go into art because you want to make money, because you can easily come out of it as you spookily went into it. So, but make sure that you go into art and make sure you learn how to draw. If you don't know how to draw, get books on how to draw. Better yourself, improve yourselves. Don't be in a rush to. It took me a while. Most importantly, you must have a dream. There was a time I was saying, God, when am I going to be recognized for what I do? But with time, that came along. I would say, when am I going to be as popular as that artist? When am I going to be well known as that artist? Or when is my work going to be recognized? And that was with time, because I was challenged to better myself. And if the young ones can do that, learn, there's a saying, an African saying that says a baby has to crawl before it walks. You have to learn, and then go into the professional world to do whatever you want to do, and put your heart to it. And also keep away from distractions, because distractions can bring you down, or distractions can make you fall. So it's very important to remain focused. And I'm grateful for my children as well. I taught them to remain focused on what they do, and they're doing very well professionally now. And that makes me happy. Hope I've been able to answer your question.
That is, congratulations on that, because it seems like, you definitely did, because especially the comment you made on group joining, and how that support is definitely needed, and embracing your individuality, because everybody has their own style, you know. And I think the world is always looking for that innovative appeal.
Of course.
For each artist to say, I have my own style. I may be a little like this person. I may want to be like this person, but I have to be me, and I have to embrace my own individuality.
True.
And embrace my own style.
When I tell children, when I'm teaching children to draw, I say, I want to see the next creator of another new character, not the Simpsons, not Spider-Man, but original ideas, because right. out there, the studios are always looking for new ideas, not ideas that already have been established, and they're looking for new ideas, not established ideas. So we need, the young ones need to come up, grow into coming up with original ideas, not the existing ideas.
Exactly. Everybody's looking for the next new, exciting art form. So this is amazing. Yeah. Do you, well, this has been wonderful, Tayo. I have truly, truly enjoyed your presentation. I've enjoyed our conversation. And are there any last words that you want to leave our audience before we conclude?
I'll just say thank you for watching. Thank you for listening to me. I saw one of the messages saying, Tayo the teacher, this is great. Tayo is a legend, someone says. Tayo, got any tips on drawing? Well, I've said that anyway. And yes, it's good to read. And so all this, thank you all for the lovely comments about what I do. I'm very much encouraged by that. I'm so much encouraged. And I also want to thank you as well and the Smithsonian for inviting me to do this. I'm so, so grateful for being on this platform. And I know there's more to come.
thank you, everyone.
Grateful.
For joining us all the way from the UK. And thank you for taking the time. Show us your work. I mean, I know it's late over there, so thank you for taking the time. I want to thank
you. It's past my bedtime.
I know. Is it 11 o'clock? I want to thank you for your energy, your joy. This has been an amazing evening for you, day, afternoon for us, and all over the world. I want to thank everyone who tuned in to learn and to be inspired by our Nigerian artist, Tayo Fatunla. And I would like all of you to have a wonderful evening or afternoon. Thank you.
Wherever you are, keep
drawing.
Wherever you are,
have an amazing, amazing evening or afternoon. And please join us again. Please check our website at africa.si.edu. We have more programmings coming up. Thank you all again for joining us, and have a wonderful, wonderful day. Bye. Thank you.